Hi, welcome to Delta Sustainable Garden Classes. I'm Kristin Crouch. There are so many common perennials in your garden that you can use for cut flower bouquets. Let's just take a look at a few of the ones that I've got in the garden. I was out picking some flowers last night, and hopefully we'll take a look at some unusual flowers here. Well, not unusual, but pretty common ones that you find in the garden. This one is clematis, and I think we're all familiar with what clematis is. It's a vine. It's called Queen of the Vines, actually. And often it blooms, usually a lot of them bloom, well, you can get early blooming ones or late blooming ones. This one blooms from June to September. I have no idea what the name was. Of course, I've not kept that name. But easy to put in a vase. It lasts for quite a few days in a vase, so that's really, really nice. So just try and cut as long a stem as you can. And if you look at some of these seed heads, as your clematis starts to form its seed heads, they can create a little bit of interest for your vase too. So you might want to use some of the seed heads. And you know, obviously you're not going to wait till they start to produce their seeds and get fluffy, because then they make a mess. But just pulling out some seed heads or even some buds from your clematis will add to a bouquet. So most of us have that in the garden, so it's nice. And if it's, you know, sometimes they're kind of spilling over the garden, you've got lots of them. Now hydrangeas are another one that you want to pick if you've got them. And now I know that with our recent heat that we had, they were kind of, some of them really suffered. So hydrangeas need a lot of water. They come in all different sizes, from the large mop heads, which can grow to 6 feet, but you can get some that only grow to 3 or 4 feet. So there's a hydrangea shrub for every suitable location, and they can be grown in containers as well. And that's what I like about them. Now they do prefer afternoon shade, and I think that's what we've learned this year, that they really do need some shade. But hydrangeas are a little bit different. When I cut hydrangeas, I'll just take a stem out. You want to pick a flower that is fully formed, so probably this is one of our better choices. And usually don't pick any of the immature flowers, because once you put them into a vase, they usually kind of shrivel up and they don't do well. So you want to get a flower that's fully open, and even some that are a bit aged will do well in a vase. What I usually do though is I usually get a cup of boiling water, and then I will cut I take my fresh cut stem, I dip it in boiling water, I give it another cut, and I put it right into the arrangement. That will help your hydrangea from sort of shriveling up, and you don't want that. So I've had some in a vase for over a week now, and they've done just great. But that's sort of the trick with hydrangeas. And of course, you can dry them as well. That's always nice to just put like an inch of water in a jar and let your hydrangeas just dry naturally in the vase. Now, I think for a lot of us, most of us have at least one rose in the garden. People seem to think roses are really hard to grow, but I love roses. Now the roses that are hybrid tea roses, they usually have these long stems, and this is one that I've took cuttings from my mum's garden, and it's got this beautiful, beautiful pink flower on it, and I love it. And it's got several buds. So sometimes you have to forfeit these buds when you want to make an arrangement. You might have to bring, but it's nice to have the buds in the arrangement as well. They will not open because they're tightly closed, and you want to make sure you get a long stem, and you want to remove any foliage off the bottom, because you don't want, when you're putting them into the vase, you want to basically don't want any leaves that are going under the water. To get your roses ready for the vase, you want to cut your rose underwater to avoid that neck from falling over and getting air in the stem. It's the airlock that has it. So I'm going to put it in this little bowl of water. I'm just going to cut it under, and I'm going to cut on the diagonal, because the more surface area for water to take up, the better. And then once you've got it cut, you can just pop it into your water, into your vase with other flowers, and you're good to go. They're really beautiful, and you want to get them when before they're like, this is not quite fully open, and they're quite pliable. If you wanted to make it look a little bit more open, you could actually play with the petals to try and bend them open a little bit. If you really want a really fully open look, sort of more of a natural look, that would be good too. So they're pretty easy. Just be really gentle. And if you've got some leaves there, petals on the outside that don't look so good, you can always remove those to make it look better, because sometimes the outer ones have a little bit more wear and they easily break off. You can just take them off here. I'm going to try that on camera. Let's see if it works. So you can just remove those. You can see that those ones aren't the best, and then just use that the rest of it. So you can sort of play around with the flowers a lot too. Another flower that I like, so there's lots of different flowers in your garden. We have our annuals, our perennials, and our biennials. So basically I'm showing you most of the perennials, but this is one here. And I love this because this lasts for like almost a week to 10 days in a vase. This is Diantha Sweet William, and it's a biennial. So you're probably thinking, what's a biennial? I knew what a perennial is. A perennial that comes back every single year. Annuals only grow for 1 year, and then die. But a biennial, basically, it produces its leaves in the first year and then flowers in the second. So if you're wanting to put sweet William in the garden now, you want to start seeds now because they won't bloom until next year. So I've already started my seeds for next year. But these flowers come in all sorts of shades of pinks and whites and rose colors, and there's some double colors here. They're absolutely stunning, and they do really, really well in a vase. And don't forget, you would always strip your leaves off the bottom of them and then do a fresh cut and then put them in your arrangement. But just such a lovely plant in the garden. And I just group them all together, and they've been blooming for, in the garden, they've probably been blooming for over a month, maybe even longer than that, like probably about close to 2 months. So they really hold, they hold well. And you can collect seeds from them. Once you can let them, leave them in the garden, let them brown up, you can collect seeds. And they may drop seeds on their own as well. Another category that we haven't covered is some of the bulbs. Now, of course, it's not springtime now, so I can't show you daffodils and tulips, but they make great cut flowers. But I love the alliums. The alliums, this is the drumstick allium, and I just think this would be a really cute flower to use in an arrangement, because it also can give you some vertical height in an arrangement. But there's also the big purple sensation mix, you know, with the big purple balls. Actually, you can probably see some behind me. They're actually focused on the shed here. I've taken the dried seed heads, and these are what the alliums look like when they're finished. So I thought I'd put them out for decor. But this one blooms late, so it's blooming in July, which most of the other alliums bloomed in April and May, and they're quite a bit, and they're finished already. Another perennial that you might want to have in the garden is Verbena bonnerensis. And it's really easy. Now, you have to have somewhere for this one to grow against, because it needs some support. It does grow to about 6 feet high, and it makes this beautiful purple swath of flowers, and the bees just love it. So I have this sort of up against a fence, so where it's got some support and there's a hydrangea in front of it, so they kind of, if it's going to fall, it's just going to lean on the other plants. And sometimes they rely on other plants for support in the garden. But this is perennial. I will give you a heads up though. It does self-sow in the garden, so if you don't want it to self-sow, make sure you cut your flowers before it goes to seed. And of course, what would we do without lavender in the garden? Lavender is such a wonderful plant, and I've got a whole border of lavender, and I've been bringing it in and drying it for bouquets for winter. But you can use it in your bouquets and then hang it up to dry as well. And I'm not sure what variety of this is. I like a lot of the English lavenders, and some of them are a lighter purple and some are a darker purple. But you want to pick the lavender before it's fully in bloom. I mean, it just depends on just when maybe half of them are starting to open up, and that will actually be the best way to treat your lavender. And then it gives you a longer vase life. And of course, they're not going to die in the vase. Because they have the ability to dry on the stem, they will just look really pretty until all the rest of your flowers will be gone and the lavender will still be there for you. Now let's take a look. We also have to have fillers in the bouquet. So sometimes you might get the greenery. We talked about the greenery earlier, and we've talked about some of our perennials that we can use in the garden. Let's take a look. These are the things that I use as fillers in the bouquet. And I think you saw me walk up with this little bouquet here where I've got like different kinds of Dusty Miller and eucalyptus in it. And I've got some parsley in here, but we'll talk about that because you're probably thinking, parsley? That's crazy. So one of the things I love to use, and lady's mantle or Acamelia mollis is actually considered, and a common name is lady's mantle. Great filler with green flowers, and great as a filler in a bouquet. Looks really nice with some of the purple leaf plants, or you can just put it with some white flowers, but it's really nice to add to a bouquet, definitely. And nice, and I would just, when you're using it though, make sure that you remove some of these leaves. So you've got more stem that they're easily removed, and then you can just cut to whatever length you want in the vase. Another filler that I've always had, you're going to laugh because you're probably going to think, well, this is a weed, right? So this is Tanacetum or Feverfew. It's a common white, little white daisies. Everybody probably, if you've got a small yard, they're probably considered a weed because they tend to self-sow everywhere. Our yard is very big, so I'm always looking at things that'll fill in spots, and it makes a great little flower for the vase. So it's got little white daisies, and you know, these ones are not the best shape. The heat's really affected them, but they will come up again and they'll flush back out, and they're around nearly all season. So they'll flush out in the spring and then again in summer, and they'll just continue to bloom. So if you've got an out of the way spot where you can plant these, I've got some along the water, along our bank, and it's great. I just let them go there because it's not really an established garden. It's just kind of a wild area. And you can see they've got the yellow centers. But last year I grew another type of Feverfew, and you can see with this one, it's got these little tiny fully double flowers. they almost look like little buttons, and they really add a nice contrast. So if you were using, like, say, a big white hydrangea or a big hosta leaf in your arrangement, why not add these little tiny flowers as well to it? Because it just, you want some contrast in a bouquet. Different textures are what makes a good bouquet, so that's what you want. And I like this one. I think it's called Snowball, and I just grew it from seed, and now, and I put it in, it came, all came back this year, so I'm never sure if things are going to come back or not, but it does. And it does well in a dry shade area as well. So that's what's great about this plant, is it's very drought tolerant as well. And it's did really well through the heat. Another plant I like to use, and you're probably thinking, oh my goodness, she hasn't let it flower, but this is your Sedum Autumn Joy. It's a succulent type plant, so it lasts for a long time in bouquets. But I like to pick it when they, and this is a small plant because it's just a new plant that went in the garden. But often they have large clusters of green buds, and you can just use those green buds as some of your filler for the bouquet. You don't even have to wait for it to bloom. So just kind of thinking out of the box, trying to use different things that you find in the garden, right? Also another plant to use in the garden is mint. Mint has flowers, and it's got a fun flower to add to a bouquet, but the sedum will last you for weeks in a bouquet. And this is a fun one to grow. I never miss that. This is an annual bunny tail grass. So easy to grow, but you know what? It gives you not only height in your bouquet, but you can see how it blows in the wind. It gives you that bouquet a little bit of movement. So if you're putting the bouquet on the patio, it kind of moves back and forth. But easy to grow from seed, and look at it. It produces these super long stems, and that's exactly what I want. When I'm looking for a good cut flower, I'm usually looking for a nice long stem so I can give different heights to my arrangements. But it's so soft, like it's one of those plants. I'm a tactile gardener and I like to go out and touch my plants, so I love using the bunny tail grass in arrangements. And of course there's all your perennial grasses as well, and you know it's still early, but a lot of the perennial grasses are coming out now, and they're going to be into bloom, like some of your purple fountain grass. It'll have its seed heads come up, so think to use those kind of ones. You can see I've got grasses behind me that haven't really sent up their seed heads yet, but I will be using those again in the fall. So fall seems to be, or late summer is the time for grasses to really shine. Now I told you earlier I'm using, like, think out of the box. This is parsley. Now I've used cilantro flowers when my cilantro was in the garden and I let it flower, but now I've let my parsley go to seed because it attracts beneficial insects. But look at these cute little umbel-shaped flowers, and they're green. So if you're looking for greenery in the garden, you can use these. I mean, it's just easy, just nice long stems, and you're probably gonna have some beneficial insects attracted to your bouquet, but if it's inside, it won't matter. But think about those, and then you can create your own bouquet. So the next thing we're gonna look at is some of the stars of your bouquet, because you've got your leaves. We talked about the greenery. We talked about a few perennials, and now we've talked about the fillers. But let's take a look at those really special plants that are gonna make your bouquet just rock.